will stop.
Abused children are helpless unless you help.
Find out how. Write Prevent Child Abuse, Box 2866, Chicago, Illinois, 60690.
Right now, I'm in Las Vegas. There's the ring. That's where it happened last night. Muhammad Ali didn't have another miracle in him, and Larry Holmes is the champion. I spoke with both Muhammad Ali and Larry Holmes in our first hour this morning. In a moment on the newscast, we'll hear some of those conversations. Also in this half hour, Gene Kelly back with us. More of my conversation with Gene Kelly, and he talks about raising his children by himself since his wife died about 8 years ago. And Joan London's going to tell us what else in this half hour, Joan.
David, Mary Ellen Pinkham's going to have one of those tips that you always wonder why you didn't think of yourself. Also, Storm Field will have the weekend weather outlook, but before all of that, it's 30 minutes after 8, and Bob Brown has the news for us. Good morning, Bob.
Good morning, Joan. Good morning, everyone. Well, before last night's heavyweight contest in Las Vegas, Muhammad Ali talked a good fight, but once in the ring, action dominated talk as Larry Holmes controlled the contest from start to finish. The one-sided action lasted 10 rounds until Ali's corner threw in the towel and Holmes won on a TKO. A dispirited Ali talked to David Hartman earlier this morning on Good Morning America.
I'm not one for excuses. I never look for cop-outs. But I just, something was wrong. I wasn't myself. I threw no punches. I couldn't get away from punches. And I'm convinced that coming down from 260 to 217 was a little too quick.
Thought maybe I would hurt him. I did slack up a few times, which I don't usually like to do. But in this case, I did again, and I don't really like to see any fighter hurt. We work so hard to get where we at, and we don't want to go out and hurt anybody because they're human beings, and evil and hurting people is not within me.
In other news, both Iraq and Iran this morning claim control of the key port city of Khorramshahr in southern Iran. Iran has ordered its troops to take the offensive, while Iraq admits its forces now are on the defensive, trying only to hold on to territory already.
Starsky and Hutch.
It's about 16 minutes after right now. Heavyweight boxing has been all over the sports pages and the front pages of all the papers these past couple of days and is going to continue to be. Ken Norton massacred Dwayne Bobic the other night in New York. And now Ken Norton wants to fight Muhammad Ali and take another shot at the crown. But first, Muhammad Ali has a fight on Monday night against a relative unknown by the name of Angelo Alfredo, rather Evangelista. Well, Muhammad Ali, the champ, is in our studio in Washington this morning. It's nice to have you with us. Good morning, Muhammad.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Thank you. James Earl Jones, who co-starred in your movie with you, said that you were very calm, very serious, very sensitive, very sane. Is that about right?
Well, we had a nice time together. I think they were surprised at my acting ability, and they thought they would have to carry me and help me along, but me, Ernest Borgnine, John Molly, and Robert Duvall, we all did good together.
James Earl Jones also said that he likes the way you jump all over Howard Cosell. You don't jump all over Cosell, do you?
No, we rather not talk about those people. They're famous enough now.
Who, Cosell?
Yeah.
I just read in the paper this morning, Muhammad, that that Ken Norton was under the impression that, and we have all been led to believe, that that Norton would have a shot at you if he won that fight the other night, which he did very well.
And yeah, we had a contract with, forgot the man's name. He was to put up $12 million for me, $100,000 for 30 days to hold us, which he did, non-refundable. After the 30 days, he was to put up another $1 million, non-refundable. After the million, he was supposed to have 30 more days to get 3 more million, non-refundable. After the 4 million, non-refundable was put up, we believe we would get the rest. Then he had another 3 months to get 8 more million, which is 12. He put the first 100,000 up, and for the other million, which he was supposed to put up, we gave him an extra week to do it, and he never made the deadline, so that contract's broke. But we will fight Norton. See, let me say one thing, get real straight right now. Fans are like this. My record is so good, I defeat everybody. I don't duck nobody. I won't have it said that I got out of boxing ducking somebody. Jimmy Young put up a good fight with me. He deserves a title shot. Norton deserves a title shot. I'm 35 years old now. I'm not going to hang around two more years waiting to prove nothing. Let these two fellas eliminate each other. See, Ken Norton, if he don't fight me, he'll never make over $500,000. Jimmy Young, if he don't fight me, he'll never make over a couple of $100,000. If they fight me, they'll be guaranteed about $4 or $5 million. So prove that they're worth it. I built boxing. I made myself. Now let these two guys fight each other. Jimmy Young fight Ken Norton, and whoever's the best, then I fight him. That way I kill two birds with one stone. If I beat the man between those two who's the best, then naturally I'm the greatest of all time. So I'm waiting now for Norton to fight Young, and then I'll fight the winner. That's fair. Because if I fight Norton and don't fight Young, they're going to say, you're ducking Jimmy Young, you're ducking Jimmy Young. If I go fight Jimmy Young, you're ducking Norton, you're ducking Norton. Let those two bad dudes get together, and I'll whoop the baddest one, destroy him. Then they'll have no doubt that I'm the greatest of all the crowd. So this is what we're waiting for. After I fight this Evangelista, who they're saying is nothing, I'm sure that Evangelista is better than Bavik. I'm sure Evangelista would go longer with Norton than Bavik. My sparring partners, Bavik's brother, will go longer with Norton than Bavik did. The fights that you call so great. I fought an unknown here a year ago in the same city, Landover, Maryland, named Jimmy Young. He was unknown. I fought another unknown 4 weeks before that, 4 years before that. They call him Ken Norton. These unknowns are dangerous. And the great guys like George Foreman, who's always so great, they're retired. Joe Frazier's retired. Dwayne Bavik turned out to be a little amateur. And all these nobodies are great people. So I predict that Evangelista will be a better fighter and give me more trouble than Bavik gave Norton. And I'm greater than Norton.
Listen, there's some people, aren't there some people right now who are going to be saying that you're ducking Norton? You just said you're 35 and you don't, you know.
That's what I'm trying to say. If I go fight Norton and give him a whipping, then I'm ducking Young. Or if I go fight Young, I think Young deserves a shot quicker than Norton. Young destroyed a man who destroyed Norton. Norton, Foreman destroyed Norton. And Norton wants nothing else to do with Foreman. Even if Foreman come back, he's got the style to knock out Norton every day in the week. But Young beat him, so I rank Young over Norton. Norton beat a Bavik, who was a white boy. They played him to be so great. The boy had no defense. He had no style. He got hit. He couldn't recover. It was a disgrace. They pushed that man. They gave him a name because he's on his white fight out here. They played him up to be really better than he was. Norton got a lot of credit he don't deserve. He didn't have a warm-up. This man has no style.
Muhammad, excuse me, just a second. Let's roll that tape. Here it is right now. Would you
look
call
at it, fella, look, right now. Any amateur can do better than Bavik. I don't know what happened to Bavik. He's in hitting range. Look at him. He's getting hit over and over. Anybody, look, he's just open right here. Watch him. He won't move right now. He should get out of the way. Another one. He just, as if to say, hit me, hit me. Look at the defense. No style, no experience, no class. That was no kind of test for Norton. Even with a broken jaw, I didn't get hit that bad. When my jaw broke, fought Norton 3 years ago when he was younger. Look at those punches. Over and over, the man can't move. He no experience. Right now, he should at least move. Right now, he's got a chance. If he just moves, there goes another one. Now, what's he going to do? He's going to fall down, get right up, and run into another one. This man was overranked. He was played to be greater than he was, and Norton just cashed in on something that he really don't deserve. He's a good fighter, but he's not that great. Norton is not. See, Bavik wasn't really too hot.
Does Norton look sharper here than he did in his last fight with you? Some people said he was introduced the other night, Norton was, as an uncrowned champion. How did you like that?
Well, I'll tell you something. They had a thing on the judges said I won 8 rounds and he won 7. So the experts got on television at a nationwide show. They reviewed the fight. Joe Frazier and Dick Young, of all people, my two worst enemies, were the judges. In round 14, on that TV show to reveal that Norton was robbed, it backfired on them. In round 14, they had 7 rounds for Norton and 7 rounds for me. Now, the man who won the last round won the fight. Everybody knew I won the last round. I won 2 minutes of the first round. It was that close. I lost the last minute. What did the panel on television say? That round was a draw. So they decided on television, showing the fight to the world, trying to reveal the boxing authorities of New York is not knowing what they're doing, trying to reveal me as not the real champion and Norton is the crown champion. What happened? It backfired. They on television with their panel before the public found that the fight was a draw. Well, in any case, the champion wins the draw.
Muhammad, we're out of time, I'm sorry to say. Thanks a million for being with us this morning.
Thank you. And I asked for a budget, but they said you have no budget. So I like your show. I love your style, but you'll pay so cheap, I won't see you for a while.
Thanks, Bob.
Something's wrong. Where last year in the United States, an estimated 1 million children suffered.
Inadequate, and 44% would support the idea of a consumer boycott. So it would seem that the phrase consumer beware is taking on a new twist, and that is manufacturers and advertisers watch out. David?
Thank you, Sandy. 17 after right now. Last time Muhammad Ali was with us on the show, he gave us this inspired bit of verse. I like your show, I like your style, but your fees are so low, I ain't coming back for a while.
Well,
good morning.
They upped the salary, so I came back.
Wait a minute. We have to straighten this out.
Nah,
we haven't paid you.
I was joking.
I know you are. Listen, after the fight, Muhammad, a lot of people, whether in the press, it doesn't matter, have said they think you ought to retire. Some of your own people say that they think you might like to retire. Why do you keep fighting? Do you really need the money that much?
No, it's not that. I just like it. And like, if I say get out now, they'll say I'm ducking Norton. I was ducking Young.
Yeah.
These fellas have actually built up credibility, and people actually think that they have a chance. So I want them two to fight each other, and then I'll fight the winner. Then that's when I plan to get out.
Well, you said that one time, at least you were quoted as saying, that you had made somewhere, you'd estimated that you'd made around $42 million fighting, and that you don't have any of it. Where is it gone? Do you give it away?
I never said nothing like that. That's not true.
Well,
I don't
that's
know.
A misquote.
Then. No, no.
But are you concerned about the money?
No.
Because you keep giving it away.
Not worrying about money. Well, you know, we should help people and help charitable people. And I believe one day we're all going to die. And if we don't be right with God, the money will help us if we have to live eternally in hell. So I do my part for charity. Not every individual I give money, but organizations and people and whoever I can help. Because we're bound to by religion.
You've become an international hero. You know that as well as I do. And we're talking seriously here. There are young people all over this world who look to you as an example. And if you, as a result of not having money later on, you know, can't retain that kind of position, are you doing a disservice to those young people who look to you?
Now, I don't know where this talk comes from about not having money.
Yeah.
I don't like to talk about, I think it's Amos and Andy for a black man to talk about his private business. You can't get Robert Redford, Paul Newman, or John Wayne, or Elvis Presley, nobody talk about how much money they got, so why should I tell everybody about my money?
You were quoted as saying that you're going to be a better actor, greater actor, than all those guys you just mentioned.
Well, I think I already am. because the mere fact that everything that I've done since 1964, my publicity, writing my own scripts, acting certain scenes before fights, promoting them, people actually believe that I was serious or wild or crazy or cocky or conceited. Whatever I did, I made them believe it so much so until now I'm the world's most popular human. You take everybody in Hollywood, take all the athletes in America, take all your so-called celebrities, and let's get on an airplane and travel around the world and I'll have to introduce them. See, and so whatever I did made me bigger than Hollywood, made me more popular than everything Hollywood can produce. If you had a worldwide television and everybody's home on earth in every country, and they had one thing to watch, and they could watch the World Series at the same time, the Kentucky Derby, the Indianapolis 500, the Super Bowl, the Rose Bowl, a Muhammad Ali fighting in Diddy Georgia, fighting a Sam Jones. Worldwide, more people, 80% of people, or 90%, will watch Muhammad Ali and forget everything else America can produce worldwide. So this is because of my acting ability.
Let's look at a clip from the film. Mm-hmm. This is a scene where you are getting interested in the Muslim religion for the mm-hmm. first time with mm-hmm. Malcolm X. Here's that clip.
Cash, all your life, you've been training for one thing, the heavyweight championship of the world.
That's right, and I will be the next heavyweight champion of the world. I go to bed thinking about it, I dream about it, So why are you bringing this up?
What, don't you realize what the papers are gonna do? They say that Malcolm X is the most dangerous man in America today.
Oh, yeah, they say he's the most dangerous man in the world, but he walked up here by himself. There's no bodyguards. I don't see no police out here, but he's the most dangerous man in the world. Why are white people so afraid of the name Malcolm X?
Well, because of, well, I don't know, maybe it's his religion.
Look, Angelo, when it comes to boxing, you're the man. You are the sole reason for me being where I'm at today. Now, why are you worried about religion? Just take care of the boxing. I'll worry about my
religion. Because you already got a faith. Why don't you stick with it?
My faith, Christianity, is the white man's faith. Your Jesus is white. Your angels are white. Your Lord's Supper's white. Everything is white. I have to wait till I die to go to heaven while you have everything now. I mean, why? Let me worry about my religion.
Is religion the most important thing in your life?
I think it should be in everybody's life. I'll say this. We live about 80 to 90 years at the longest. Let's assume there's a heaven, there's a hell. Everybody in the sound of my voice, are you going to heaven or are you going to hell according to your deeds? Now, to burn eternally in hell is nothing compared to the 80 years we live here on earth. Howard Hughes had all the money. I mean, this is going to soon be forgotten. This television show, this whole station will soon be off there. There'll be another show. This country may be another 1,000 years. They might name another country. But eternity in hell, that's like taking the Sahara Desert and somebody told you to clean all the sand out of the desert at a grain at a time, and each grain represents 1,000 years. And every 1,000 years move a grain until that desert is empty. And that's a long time to be in hell. So the little time we have here on earth, like all the rich people that come in there, I bought a farm in Barren Springs, Michigan, Al Capone had. He's dead, the same farm is there. Four more fellas had it, the farm is there. The man I'm buying it from, maybe dead one day, the farm is there. When I'm dead, the same farm. We're just trustees, we don't own nothing. So once we realize that earthly things are good for a while, I mean women, wine, song, you're gonna soon be old if you live. If you be too old, you can't enjoy it. See, Howard Hughes couldn't even enjoy it as well. So what I'm trying to say, main thing to me now that I understand is getting prepared with God where when I die, if there is a heaven somewhere, I want to make it. So that's the most important thing.
Thank you. We're out of time.
Good luck. Life can really be tough if you don't know how to read.
Right now in America, just about 21 million people over 16 can't read.
That's where RIF comes in.
Find out. But we did, and the actors should know that the children were ecstatic about their visit with the stars. I'm Ruth Batchelor in Hollywood. David?
Thank you, Ruth. 19 minutes before 8 right now. When I think of Muhammad Ali, the first thing I think of, obviously, is what he has done as a boxer, the greatest, if you will. But there is a whole other side to Muhammad Ali that we also know about, Ali the Salesman. And there's a new book out. The book is called How I Made the Sale That Did the Most for Me. And Muhammad Ali is one of the 50 people who tell of their sales experiences. His section in the book is called Selling Oneself in Boxing. Good morning, Champ.
Thank you.
How you doing? You all right? You all right?
I'm feeling nice. How are you?
I'm great, thank you. Let me read to you.
You read? Yes,
I am. I may not be the greatest, but I'm close. Watch it, Ali! It's early. Let me read to you a quote from the book. Quote, Ali, I am a very quiet person, very bashful. Don't like to talk in front of people, very shy when it comes to television, unquote. Who wrote that?
I did.
You wrote that?
Well, lately, since I've retired, people have been saying he's not talking, he's mumbling, he's quiet, something's wrong with him, maybe he took too many punches. I'm just acting myself. I was acting all during my fight career, it was all act. I got this from Gorgeous George, I'll say it many times.
Gorgeous George?
Yeah. Making people angry, I'm the greatest, I'm pretty. I mean, that was true, but I just put it in. Anyway, this made people come to see if I could do it. Some wanted me knocked out, some wanted me to win, and some didn't. So that's how I sold myself, just being cocky and bashful and confident, bold.
But you know, most people, if they are really shy, if they are really bashful and so forth, it's very hard for them to come out and do the kind of things that you did.
I think there are many actors and people in public life who have to give a show of being not shy, who are really shy in real life, I'm sure they are.
Mm-hmm. How important, How good would your career have been? How great would your career have been if you hadn't been good at selling yourself?
Not as good as it was, because I wouldn't have been on the spot I was on. When I make a prediction, say a certain thing, I'd have to do. I'd have to work. Some mornings I didn't want to run. I would have to get up and run because I've done all this talking. People are waiting and watching, and I can't let them prove me wrong. Certain writers will say this and that. And this is what really motivated me to go. But if I hadn't put myself on such a spot, I wouldn't have worked like I did.
Let me show you a piece of tape. You and I had a conversation early in the morning, about 4:30 in the morning, last October, the morning after you were TKO'd by Larry Holmes in Las Vegas. Look at this, and this is what you
Maybe
said to me.
We may go back and try for some other title.
All right, so you may go after
As
Mike Weaver.
As MacArthur says, I shall return. They wrote me off after Frazier. They wrote me off after Norton. They wrote me off after Spinks. They wrote me off after the draft. Don't write me off.
Never. I would never do that. I'm not going to write you off. But are you still thinking about it? Are you? You have said many times I'm retiring.
I haven't formally retired yet. But there are people trying to get something in Ghana, Africa. They mentioned Philippines. They mentioned Haiti, Jamaica. This country probably wouldn't allow certain promoters and commissioners. He's too old, champ quit, you'll get hurt and all this stuff. But we would probably, if I do, to show them that I'm not hurt and that I'm still the greatest, that I can still go. There was a fluke the night of our homes. We'd have to probably go out of the country and prove it.
So you think it was a fluke?
Oh, man, I know it wasn't. I couldn't throw no punches. I couldn't die. I couldn't get away. 11 rounds, there had no perspiration on me. I wasn't myself. So I know I can do better now. I don't want to go out like this. So I owe it to myself and to go out looking much better.
Who would you fight, Muhammad?
Well, we're looking at, we don't want to say who, call no names because the price goes too high. But one of them we can mention is the heavyweight champion of all Europe, John L. Gardner.
So you're really seriously considering a fight, though?
Considering. I told them, I don't like the idea of people telling me, we're going to retire you. I've done too much in boxing. I'm too great for some flat commissioner to tell me, you either I'm going to retire you, you're not allowed. So to show them that I can do what I want to do, I wrote a thing. It says, the world is my home, and every country is only a room. And all the people of all races are my brothers and sisters. So this room might not allow me, but I have a room in Nigeria, I have a room in Ethiopia, a room in Scotland, a room in Germany, a room in Russia and China if I want it. So if you don't let me work in this room, I'll go to another room. It's just the idea of them telling me I can't.
Right. So you don't like people telling you you can't.
You
right?
can't. We're not going to let you. We're going to stop you. I'll show you can. I'll go somewhere else and do it.
Looking back at the Norton-Cooney fight, well, obviously, Kenny got creamed that night. What did you think of his decision to fight Cooney?
Well, I thought it was wrong, but many things I've done, people thought was wrong, so I can't complain. Norton, like myself, is getting in the age for sports, and Cooney is just a hard, hard hitter. He's knocked out everybody, and I figured he would knock Norton out, but I didn't know it would be so quick. But Norton's a good fighter, but I heard he wasn't in the shape he should have been in. But who can say? Maybe he might be better.
Would you like Cooney? You like Cooney? Would you like to fight Cooney?
No, I don't know. he hits so hard, he'll jar your kinfolks in Africa.
Your kinfolks? Muhammad, you got a trick. I told him you had a surprise
for us. Magic is my hobby. People
when
don't know
the, that. Show us.
I've been doing magic for about 12 years.
Show us. Show us. I didn't
kids.
Know this.
This is for kids and grown-ups who are mentality-wise like kids.
Me. That's me.
Now, what we have here is a yellowish-green scarf, right?
Right.
Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to stick it in my hand.
Right.
And I'm going to press it down real good. Now, I got to my hand. Now, I'm going to open my hand, and everything's going to disappear.
You sucker.
There.
You.
There's nothing there. Now, watch careful. Here's my hands.
Peanut butter and jelly nothing, sandwiches.
Nothing's going down my sleeves. Watch careful. I'm going to bring it back. You don't see it, do you?
Huh? You sucker. Look at
now
that.
I got another for you.
You do?
One more. Now,
go.
I do this in schools, old folks' homes. And by everybody, all of you out there, who were looking for good musicians. I just Doug Henning and people like that, they got to move now.
Okay. Watch out.
What we going to do here? What we going to do here? We have a pinkish tent scarf, right?
Got it.
Let me take my jacket off so
okay.
You can see.
Oh, what? You got your microphone?
Nothing's
okay.
In my sleeves.
Okay.
Because most people think you have some on.
Okay. Go. And
now, I'm clear, right? There's nothing here for me.
Right.
From nowhere, and this is really great.
Go.
I got to just say, be and be it is. Isn't that pretty good?
Yeah, Schwarzenegger is here. You know him?
Schwarzenegger.
Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know him?
Schwarzenegger.
I didn't say that. You said that.
What you say? What you say?
Arnold Schwarzenegger. I didn't say that, Ali. We'll be back in a minute with Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's his name. You.
Your first pet. Will you ever forget the day you got him? Well, by the time Spot and I got acquainted, I was ready for some Kool-Aid. I loved it. And Mom loved it, because it was economical. Still is. With my sugar, Kool-Aid unsweetens about one-third the price of soda. Has vitamin C, soda doesn't. And with that fruity taste, it's a kid's second best friend.
You loved it as a kid, you trust it as a mother. Kool-Aid brand unsweetened soft drink mix.
Hey, honey, what's that? New Maxwell House Master Blend coffee?
The new ground coffee that can save us money.
But how does it taste? That means it tastes like Maxwell House.
New Master Blend, 100% pure ground coffee. Not concentrated, not flaked, because we make it a special way. It's the great tasting coffee that can save you money.
Great coffee.
New Maxwell House Master Blend, great tasting coffee that can save you money.
Wednesday.
Hi.
Charlie's Angels are back in action when a hypnotist turns Julie into an angel killer. Then, on The American Dream...
We're Novaks, right?
Father and son team causes foul play at home.
You're both just alike. You're both jocks. They're the big, dumb jocks.
And on Vegas, terror follows Dan when he teams up with a beautiful psychic who carries a premonition of death.
The critics are talking about ABC's World News Tonight.
State Department spokesman said again today.
Frank Reynolds, poised and knowledgeable. The Philadelphia Inquirer.
Two Soviet bombers were met by
Max Robinson, no-nonsense and authoritative. The Cleveland Press.
In other news overseas...
Peter Jennings, the new image of a foreign correspondent. The New York Daily News.
Meanwhile, rumors...
Barbara Walters, one of the best interviewers on television. The Detroit News. The one to watch, ABC's World News Tonight.
Nine minutes before eight right now, Muhammad Ali is still with us, and also Arnold Schwarzenegger, who has won every major award in bodybuilding. He has also gone on to make movies, Pumping Iron, his latest movie not out yet called Conan. He's now written a book called Arnold's Bodybuilding for Men, and it's just in time to help those of us who need a little help. Good morning, Arnold.
Good morning.
It's nice to see you again. In looking at the book, I see that you say you need the discipline, you need commitment, you need three times a week and diet and work hard and so forth. But a lot of us don't really want to look like that. I don't know that we ever could look like that, like you look. But is there something in your book for all of us that just want to be in better shape?
Well, yes. The latest book that I've written is for people like yourself or for the businessman and for the person that really doesn't have much time. Because I realized that a few years already ago that there are not many people that are interested really being a world champion. Maybe there are 100,000 in this country or around the world. But the majority of people really don't have enough time to train 4 hours a day. So what I did was I wrote a book that really shows a businessman or somebody that doesn't have much time how he can get in shape or how he can lose 40, 50 pounds of body fat or gain body weight within a short period of time and just working out 3 or 4 times a week for half an hour.
All right. Muhammad,
so you don't need much sacrifice, you don't need much dieting, you just do a little bit of it, but do it continuously. And it shows you in the book pretty well how to do that.
All right. Can for instance, Muhammad, now you're not working out now. If you don't work out, how long before you're out of shape?
Well, 3 weeks.
3 weeks. How about you, Arnold? How long does it take you to be out?
Well, I really have never laid off 3 weeks. You know, I've been doing always something continuously. Even when I was in Spain now filming, I have done 1 hour of exercising with weights every day, and I've done some running 3-4 miles every day.
Three or four miles a day?
Yeah, so I really don't know how long it would take me, but probably also 3 or 4 or 5 weeks. I don't know, you know, because whenever I lay off the weight training, I also go on a diet. You know, I eat less, so I don't gain body weight.
Is your strength different from Muhammad's? Is his different?
Yes, we just tested it in the back.
You did?
I said, let's scuffle, just push each other. You push me over here and I'll push you. And he just picked me and walked me right across the room. He is so strong, he needs band roll on.
Hey, listen, Alan Hale is with us. Alan, come on in. No, Arnold, show us some of these exercises that can help in all of us who need a little help in certain areas. Show us, tell us what Alan's going to do, would you?
Well, first, an exercise that I always like people to do is to firm up their arms. It's a triceps extension with a dumbbell. What you do is you just take the dumbbell and you let it down behind your neck, keep the upper arm close to your head, and just let the triceps work. What it does is it stimulates the triceps, which is the muscle behind the arm here, and it will firm it up. This is regardless now of men or women. Both can do those exercises, yes.
Now, show us the next one.
The next exercise is a curl with two dumbbells. A curl with the two dumbbells. Or with a barbell.
All right. Is all of this expensive?
No, no. This is a press, a military press, which firms up the shoulders, and it gives you this, athletic build, physique look, you know, which is
just move it around, but it doesn't necessarily make you look like you look.
No,
right?
I mean, this is just, it firms you up. These are exercises that burn off calories, that firm you up, and that make you look better when you go to the, you know, in the summer when you go to the beach. Most men like to look attractive and so on.
Sure.
And so these are the kind of exercises everybody can do, regardless of how strong you are or in what kind of condition you're in or how old you are. I mean, the important thing is that you should do, fitness is for everybody, young or old, women or men, it doesn't matter.
But at the same time, check with a doctor, right? Make sure you don't overdo.
Yeah, these are the important things that you check with the doctor if you can do it. For instance, people that have a high blood pressure maybe should go for a physical checkup and find out if they ought to do it, you know, if the doctor recommends it. Usually it is for everybody. I mean, it's right now the big, fastest growing activity in America.
Feel better, get healthy.
Oh, yeah.
That's good, healthy. Arnold's Bodybuilding for Men. Thank you, Arnold. It's nice to see
you. Thank you very much.
Muhammad, thank you. You want to get in shape? Can you help him? You know?
He's in shape, believe me. I've seen his fights. He is in shape.
We'll be back in just a minute. Thank you, Muhammad. Thanks, Arnold. Four minutes before 8 right now. We'll be back after these words. Thanks, Alan.
You look these days, you'll see America firming up. Millions are discovering just how good fitness feels.
I'm Susan Anton. Fitness that feels good by day needs firmness that feels good by night.
Stars to changing times, TV 375, Washington, D.C.
Good morning, America. With me today, a man who has made his own introduction. He calls himself The Greatest, which is the title of his autobiography, and also the title of the new $5 million movie based on that book, in which he will play himself on the silver screen. Welcome to Good Morning America, Ollie.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
In your book, The Greatest, did you tell the whole truth? What did you leave out?
Well, wouldn't want to tell you on the show. I'd be sitting here lying, and any intelligent person would know to tell you the whole truth about what I have done through my life, to tell you it all. And I'm sure you would not sit here on this show and tell the whole truth. I'll write a book and tell really the whole truth about yourself, because we all figure there's some things that we used to do that we've done and still do.
You're talking to the wrong person.
That we don't want nobody to know about.
The truth of the matter is I wrote a book about myself in which I told everything. Yes, everything.
Well,
and I wasn't ashamed about it either.
What would you consider the worst thing you told?
The worst thing I told?
probably about my relationship with my parents and how I might have felt about them at certain times in my life.
With men in privacy.
In men in privacy, I discussed everything.
All that? Everything you do?
I certainly did, sir.
Oh, it's so hard to believe.
Well, I can give you a copy of the book.
I would love to see the copy.
You told
everything you did in private?
Everything that I did in private, because I thought it was rather interesting, and I thought other people could learn from it. Don't you want other people to learn from you?
Not that kind of stuff.
How does it feel, though, playing yourself, reliving your own life, whether it is part fiction, part film?
Well, I was told by the pros, like Ernest Borgnine, John Marley, the guy was in Godfather and Love Story, played the father in Love Story, and James Earl Jones, that, and other people, they said the hardest thing to do for actors is to play yourself. That's the hardest thing in acting. Mm-hmm. And I think I've mastered that.
Holly, what gave you the impetus to want to make something of yourself rather than just remain one of the masses?
That's a good question. The first time it's ever been asked of me. When I was 12 years old, I wonder. I believe that everybody has a purpose. I have a lecture called The Purpose of Life. Trees have a purpose. The rain has a purpose. Snow, the moon, everything God created has a purpose. And it is the knowledge of the purpose which enables every soul to fulfill it. The wise man is he who knows his life purpose. Whether small or large, we all have a purpose. So at 12 years old, I want to be a big celebrity. I want to be like Joe Louis or Sammy Davis Jr. or Sidney Poitier or John Wayne or all the big names. I want to be world famous, but I want to be free.
Why did you want to be like one of these people?
So that I could rebel and be different from all the rest of them and show the other ones coming behind me that you don't have to Uncle Tom or you don't have to kiss you know what to make it. And like, look at me right now. I challenge any black man in the world other than Wallace D. Muhammad to prove he's as free as I am. I want to be free. I mean, I want to say what I want to say, like I'm doing now. Go where I want to go. Do what I want to do. Tell the draft I'm not going. And still don't be in no movies showing my behind. I got to go off of Meryl Blonde and move in Hollywood to stay tight with the big shots. I just want to be what they call not obey the law, but still walk the streets with my people.
You've called yourself the greatest. Have there been any moments in your life when you've ever felt insecure?
No, but I'm the greatest boxer. See, we have a saying in Islamic religion, Allah o Akbar means God is the greatest. Allah o Akbar. So I am the greatest boxer. So all I can really do good is to box and preach. I'm not the greatest preacher. I'm the greatest boxer. So that's all I profess to be, the greatest.
When you were a young man growing up, did people pick on you?
No. No, they didn't pick on me because I didn't bother nobody. And you have a few little skirmishes in school here and there, but you can't remember. It wasn't serious.
Did you have any traumatic experiences in doing your film, The Greatest, in reliving some of your past?
Yes. Atlanta, Georgia. When a couple of Ku Klux Klansmen told us to get out of town, nigga. We don't want no nigga in Georgia, you drive Dodger, nigga. And I got a telephone call, says, you better get out of here tonight. And we hung the phone up. And I was out in the yard shadow boxing. And there were bushes all over the field. And I'm out there shadow boxing one day, and something says, I heard a gunshot. I thought I heard a car backfire. Someone's a road was near. Heard another shot. Pow. She said, nigga, let me tell you, get out of Georgia. We hit the ground and crawled in the house. And one of the security guards, he came out on the porch firing in the crowd. Pow, pow, pow. And they got him shot off. We got the whole scene in the movie.
Have you ever been frightened of losing your life?
Yes, about twice.
When
I shouldn't have been. I should rely on God more, but still I was praying. But it's airplanes.
On airplanes?
Well, yes, the worst thing in the world is get caught in an electrical storm on a big flimsy airplane, watching as your wings shaking and taking radical dives, and you know at any moment it's going to split. I just kept thinking, who have I helped this week? Who did I give some money to? What good did I do? Because I want to see the hereafter. So I believe we're all going to die, and I know there's a heaven and a hell. If we live to be 200, that's nothing compared to eternity.
I have one final question for
you.
And it's something about you that has always confused me.
Mm-hmm.
You preach. You say some very important things. You've got a good mouth. And yet,
In a strange way, you have always said that what happens in your personal life is none of anybody's business. How can you get people to believe you on one hand in the areas that you want them to believe you in, and yet do something totally different in your private life?
Whatever mistakes I make in my private life, whatever I do, they all guilt the same thing, and they know I'm real. Just like Jesus, they caught this prostitute, man, he's getting killed, and people gonna stone a prostitute. He said, which one of you haven't sinned, throw the first stone? Couldn't none throw a stone? So you read about me with marital problems, or you see me with a girlfriend, and, oh, what man don't have no girls? As pretty as you are, how many hit on you every day? Preachers would hit on you, you so pretty. Now that means he's a bad man with God. If God can love the whole world, I surely can love some too.
I don't think I can top that, so I'll only say thank you for coming to Good Morning America.
Let's tell
America.
The truth about it. Let's don't be no phony. Yeah, we all guilty of something.
There's only one, Muhammad Ali. It's now 4 minutes before the hour. We'll be back after this from Kiplinger Changing Times magazine. Grab your pencil while there's time to get in on this special offer from Changing Times. Remember, regular subscription price of Changing Times alone is $9, but you get all this for only $3. 6 full months of Changing Times, plus 2 powerful money-making, money-saving books that you can't...
...up them in the dark room. And innocent kids led to drugs. Who can they turn to? Strike Force.
Muhammad Ali is one of the true superstars of our time. Win or lose, he'll always be the champ to his fans. Well, the champ lost his last fight to Larry Holmes, the WBC heavyweight champion. Many said that was the last we'd see of Ali in the ring. But the morning after the fight, Muhammad Ali told me this.
I shall return. They wrote me off after Frazier. They wrote me off after Norton. They wrote me off after Spinks. They wrote me off after Draft. Don't write me off.
Muhammad Ali will fight again tomorrow night in the Bahamas. Last week, I joined him and his wife, Veronica, while Ali was training for what he hopes will be his comeback.
I'm too fast.
You're fast? When were you fast? 1962?
Watch this.
What?
I just hit you twice.
I missed that. After a very serious sparring session with this aging, unworthy opponent, I asked Ali about the man he'll face in tomorrow night's fight, Trevor Burbick, who is the British Commonwealth heavyweight champion. He is 27 years old.
Burbick is slow.
What do you mean Burbick is slow?
Burbick is slow. No footwork. He walks, he stalks, he fights like that. He can't miss him up straight left jab. Man, watch the show. Good morning, America. Watch the show.
All right, let's say you take Burbick. Let's say you take Burbick. Who next?
Mike Weaver has challenged the winner. And the winner will meet Mike Weaver, and that will be me. He's WBA champion.
Burbick, then Weaver. Who's tougher for you?
I think Burbick.
Why?
Because of his style, his offer. Weaver's a boxer. Yeah. And I know how to fight a boxer. But an awkward man like Burbick can bring problems.
Muhammad, I haven't talked to one person who is knowledgeable about boxing or one person who isn't knowledgeable about medicine who really believes, honestly, that you ought to fight this fight. Uh-huh. When are you going to start listening? Are you ever going to listen to anybody who's concerned about you?
I think I love me. I know more about me than they do. Even my mother, my wife, or my children don't know me like me. So I think I'm gonna do it.
Then what are they saying to you? They're worried you might get hurt?
Well, that could happen to a man 21 years old. They do get hurt. But
the chances that you could get hurt are a heck of a lot greater at the age of 39. You're almost 40.
Am I 40?
Oh, not quite. Almost. Oh. You're losing track. Are you losing your grip?
Time flies fast, don't it? You mean I'm 40?
Be serious, Ali. Be serious. Come on. Most athletes realize when it's time to stop.
right? And I realize this. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
I know that I'm considered, I may be a little too old for what I'm doing, but I know I can do it. I know I can be Burbank. I know I can be Holmes and Weaver. I know I'm not finished. I know me better than you. I was sick the night of Four Homes. Too light, didn't move, couldn't run around. I was off. I'm gonna do better. I know I can do better. If I didn't think so, I wouldn't be trying.
Tell me about your training. How are you training right now?
Well, I can't run like I used to. I used to run 5 miles a day. I'm happy to get back 2 miles now. Where I used to do it 6 weeks before the fight, now I do it 3 months before, take longer. Where I used to box maybe 2 rounds on the heavy bag, 2 rounds on the speed bag, 3 rounds on the rope, I cut that to half. I box less than I used to box.
We talked with Ali's sparring partners about his training. First, Curtis Jackson.
I've been here about 4 weeks with the champ, and he's got a timetable that he's working on. It's a gradual thing, it takes a little time. He's losing his weight, he's not gonna dehydrate himself like he did in the last fight. So he's in good shape, he's coming along, you know, he's taking his pace. He's doing it his way this time, still listening to a lot of people tell him what he should do. And he's feeling real strong. He's hitting hard, he's still got those fast hands, and he moves.
Next, middleweight Tommy Hearns, who went a few exhibition rounds with Ali.
I think for myself that he's a much better man than Burbank. I had the pleasure of seeing Burbank fight before, and he don't have the style. That's Ali. He's not the caliber of fighter as Ali. And I feel that with Ali's ability, I feel that he could go on and beat victorious.
Another sparring partner, Jeff Stoudemire.
Well, I can't stop him, but he has his own, he's self-motivated somehow, but I feel that he should, after this one, should call it quits. Because he ain't won enough. He ain't won. Let the younger guys come along.
Here you are for so many years. You're the best in the world. You're a one of a kind. You're a unique man. There's nobody ever been like you. Nobody ever. And you know that as well as I do. And you're not number one anymore. Are you just bored that? And is that why you have to get back in?
If that's why I'm doing it, I'm in trouble. Because what am I going to do the day I have to quit for real? I got to stop sometime. I have enough sense to know I can't go forever. I'm getting old. I can't stay number one in boxing. That's not it. I'm the only man with a chance to fight for the title 4 times. 4-time world champion. You gotta take some ridicule, you gotta take some pain, people talking about you. But let me tell you, I'm gonna beat this man, Burbank, and that's gonna start. You realize who I am.
All right, you always predict your fights. What round? What round are you gonna get Burbank?
I'm not calling a round.
No, why not?
I will stop him.
You will?
It will not go the distance.
So you knock him out, either TKO or a knockout?
It will not go the distance. I tell you here, on live TV, or tape, whatever, it will not go the distance. Listen to me again. Burbank, young, 27, 28-year-old Burbank, old 39-year-old me, I'm making all you old men feel proud the next day. We're not finished if you take care of yourself. And I'll prove Burbank will be no contest.
An act? Well, Ali's always been a great performer. Can he beat Burbank? Maybe, maybe not. But every person I spoke with about this fight, his family, medical experts, fight people, are not really talking about whether Ali will win or lose the fight. Their biggest concern is could this great athlete, by his own admission, past his prime, be physically hurt, maybe for life? Well, we'll find out tomorrow night. 5 before 8 right now. We'll be back after these words from the Bell System.
By the end of this year, the Bell System American Orchestra's On Tour program will have taken 30 major symphony orchestras to over 280 cities across the United States. It's been